For the Lord our righteousness, and that day Judah will be saved and Israel will be
saved.
So, Yehovah said to you, Lord our righteousness, the Lord will come and he will reign in the midst of Israel, and you have given a holy people, people set apart for the purpose of serving Israel and all the nations. And that's who we are. So the other word here is Zerah, which is seed. Hebrew word seed. Here's another word. This is a very relevant word from where we're going here. Very relevant to where humanity seems to be destined. In fact, is destined to go. Anyone? You've done it twice before, haven't you?
Yes, sir.
Very important word. What is the devourer of your heart mean? The will of God. Of the Lord. Will of the Lord. Yehovah. Sometimes it's the will of God. But this particular word here is devourer of your heart, the will of the Lord. So I think it was last week. How the word of the Lord, the word of God, is personified in the prophets. And then when the prophets spoke in the word of the Lord, it was actually the word of God, Jesus, Yeshua, that was speaking through the prophets, that was the personification of the word of God. And so when a prophet speaks, it is the word of God that speaks through that prophet. If in fact the prophet is prophesying accordingly. And so you have also the last word, which is also a good one for us. This word is very relevant and becomes more relevant as time goes on.
It says in Zechariah that the blood will come up to the
That's another plain, like Jezreel, where we've been battling before. Between Egypt and Assyria, Babylon, Egypt, Greece, also when Greece became a power, meant the Persians, not too far from Carthage, and fought right into that same spot. So it seems like in the ancient world, certain locations, valleys, would become noted or sort of slated for battles. And Jezreel is one.
Good job.
Yeah, history. And so if a king is looking to conquer a people nearby, and you have the history of the battles fought in that spot, in that location, and the battles won, they were very superstitious. He would say, okay, his priests would say, you know, you need to fight in that valley so that you have the same victory as the Pharaoh of Egypt. And they would choose the valley for the battle. You know, logistics in the ancient world were not like what it is today. You know, today you can basically fight a battle anywhere in the world, more or less. In the ancient world, you have to really plan logistics. You know, you have to really maneuver your troops strategically. Anyway, Jezreel. Many battles fought there, and then there's going to be at least two more really grand battles fought in Jezreel. All right, let's look at our review. Page 20. We just want to take a quick review of everything we've looked at. And I do want to get some study guide work done. Am I no microphone tonight? All right. I think we got to settle that issue, right? All right. The people online can hear me to some extent. Yeah.
Yes, they can hear you.
Why don't you bring your table up a little closer so that they can hear a little better? That might help some. All right. So let's begin with Jeremiah. We're looking at the review of what we talked about and what we've done with Jeremiah. When did this prophet Jeremiah minister? What time period? We know Second Temple period, but what period? In the Second Temple period. He was a prophet that hid the Ark of the Covenant and so on. I think we talked about that last week, if I'm not mistaken. How many people went and researched Ron Wyatt from last week's discussion? All right, what do you think of Ron Wyatt? Credible, not credible?
Credible.
I think he's credible, but it's an incredible story, so you don't know. I won't believe it until I see it. So it's for Wyatt. But I personally do have history with it because of what happened, you see, at that same spot. So anyway, so we're talking about 722 BC to 586 BC. This is the period between the destruction of Samaria, the capital of the Northern Kingdom, and the Jerusalem, the capital of the Southern Kingdom. So that's the period of time that Jeremiah would have ministered. Remember Jeremiah's message, right? He wasn't a favored prophet. He wasn't a prophet that gained favor for the leadership in Jerusalem at all. They hated him because he prophesied the end of Jerusalem and that God was preparing to bring destruction upon Jerusalem and upon the people of Judah. Not a favorable message at all. Nevertheless, he was a powerful prophet. For those who would have accepted him, he would have been. The specific call of Jeremiah, let's read that. This is interesting to read. Jeremiah chapter 1, who would like to read 1 to 10 for us? This is the moment of Jeremiah's call for the ministry. Jeremiah 1 to 10.
Until
the carrying away of Jerusalem captive in the fifth month. The word of the Lord came to me, saying, Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I sanctified you. I ordained you a prophet to the nations. Then said I, Ah, Lord God, for I cannot speak, for I am you. But the Lord said to me, Do not say I am you, for I shall go to all, for you shall go to all to whom I sent you, and whatever I command you, you shall speak. Do not be afraid of their faces, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord. Then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth, and the Lord said to me, Behold, I have put my words in your mouth. See, I have this day sent you over the nation and over the kingdoms, to root out, to pull down, to destroy, to throw down, to build, and to plant.
That's an interesting call from Jeremiah. Concerning that Jeremiah never left the land of Israel, as far as we can tell, but God called him to be a prophet unto the nations, and that he will have this incredible effect in the nations. So how did Jeremiah accomplish this? So how would Jeremiah? And in fact, I have a copy of the scroll right here, the book of Jeremiah. And his word in, for instance, Jeremiah chapter 25, is very implemented in regards to the judgment that we're seeing upon the nation state. So his word is part of that implementation of God's judgment. God spoke this word to Jeremiah, and that word is being accomplished today. So this is how God is accomplishing his word through Jeremiah. What did we see? God said to Jeremiah that I have appointed to build and to plant. So this is how Jeremiah's word is accomplishing that, because it went out to Israel, and the word is among the nations, as many of the other prophets and their words are among the nations as well. But Jeremiah, remember, we talked about Jeremiah in Jeremiah chapter 25, that God was going to begin judgment in Jerusalem, and then that judgment would span out for all the nations, and ultimately will funnel down upon Babylon, Shishak, which is a cryptogram again for final form of Babylon. So this is how this has been accomplished. So God called him before he was even conceived, before he was even born. God called him to be a prophet. So we would say from the world's foundation, God appointed Jeremiah to do the work that Jeremiah would ultimately do. It speaks of God's incredible sovereignty over matters concerning him and his work of redemption. So the basic message of Jeremiah, God was preparing to judge Israel, drive Israel into the nations, and at the same time, he would also bring judgment upon the nations. What we see, and we've talked about this quite a few times, there's a conversion that occurs in time. The prophets all speak of that conversion. Even Jesus, Yeshua, made mention of that in Luke chapter 21, verse 21, I think it is. When the time of Israel's restoration is at hand, or nearing to be complete, God will turn his face away from Israel for judgment and to the nations. And Yeshua himself, he put a sort of timeline on that series of events that will ultimately lead to God's face. The Gentiles, until the time of the Gentiles is complete. So when Jerusalem, from that statement, is no longer underfoot of the Gentiles, subjugated to the Gentiles, Gentile nations, then Jerusalem, the time of the Gentiles will be complete. Jerusalem will be in the hands of the Jewish nation again, and the time of the Gentiles is complete, meaning that it's time for judgment. Right? So God said concerning the Amorite, when he spoke to Abraham, that the sin of the Amorite is not yet complete. Same type of statement. And so he was pointing to that time when, he was pointing to that time when God will judge the Amorites. Well, it's the same type of statement. The sin of the favor returns to Israel, and he begins to restore Israel at that very time he's going to countries that are playing along with the UN anyway. So this is leading to an eruption that will ultimately bring about the kinds of scenarios that we see in the book of Revelation and we talk about in Bible prophecy. So here we are. So all right, let's read on. For what basic failure was Judah guilty of relative to the covenant? Promise of righteous branch and his name. Anna Mary read that for us a few moments ago. Actually, she didn't read that particular verse, but it refers to the branch. Right? So someone read Jeremiah 23, 5 and 6 for us. Jeremiah 23, 5 and 6.
Basically what it says. So that's the new basis of relationship that God's going to establish with Israel. New covenant, in other words. And we've talked about this quite a bit. We have to relate this to a wedding. And why would we relate this to a wedding? Because Shavuot at Mount Sinai, when Israel was called to come close to God, it was comparable, or it was a comparison to a wedding. To a wedding. And that's what Sukkot, Shavuot is really about. It's about a wedding. On the day of Pentecost, Shavuot, in Jerusalem, the church was, and actually it's more like a betrothal, not so much a wedding, a betrothal. So God wanted Israel to come near to him so he could initiate this betrothal, introduce the ketubah, which is a covenant, right? So when there's a Jewish wedding, you have a ketubah. So God wanted to introduce to Israel, give to Israel the ketubah, this covenant with them. And then at a later date, he would consummate the marriage. So Sinai, Shavuot, was a betrothal event. And they chose to stay far off. And the validity of the ketubah, the law, was never initiated in Israel inwardly. It was always external, what they were committed to do, and not so much what they wanted to do. And that's the whole essence of the new ketubah that God's going to establish with Israel. They would want to obey him. They would want from within to know him, right? You know, the Hebrew word yodea is the word that's used in the text. And the word yodea, to know, is the same word as a husband knowing his wife, or a wife knowing her husband. Yodea. So God, they were all yodea, and they would all know him. He would put his law within them, and that's the consummation event. All right. Sign that God had forsaken Israel. No natural law. So if the natural law is not in place, then God will be liable to forsake Israel, right? God said it there in Jeremiah chapter 31, if there's no rising of the sun or setting of the sun, rising of the moon, then Israel can be abandoned by God. And as far as we know, that fixed order has been in place ever since the beginning of creation. So Israel is still God's people. God's covenant with Israel is still viable. Continuation of two houses in Israel. This is a reference here in Jeremiah chapter 33, the house of Israel, the house of Jacob, I think, and the house of David. The two houses there are referencing the church and Israel. Of course, you can say, well, what about the house of Israel, the north, and the house of Judah in the south? That's kind of the context in this passage that Jeremiah is referring to in Jeremiah chapter 33, 23 to 26. The context here is the entire house of Israel, house of Jacob, and the house of David. The house of David is, in fact, the church, right? We've talked about this before. You should have this noted in your Bible, that the house of David is the church. We see that in Acts chapter 15, where there was a schism, a debate among the disciples about the Gentiles coming into the former Gentiles. They were no longer Gentiles. But former Gentiles coming into the house of David, the tabernacle of David, the church. And there was a huge debate about whether they should be, you know, coercively circumcised, and then how they should treat clean them and clean them and so on. And the disciples who were more legalistic, the Judean disciples, were very heavy-handed and demanding. Peter and John and Paul, on the other hand, they were more open to the reality that these former Gentiles, by their faith, must come into observance or not observance, by their faith. And Peter made the incredible point when he said that they're being cleansed by their faith. In other words, they're not clean because of observance, they're clean because of their faith. Right? Acceptable to God, in other words, justified by faith. That's Peter's argument. And Peter kind of clinched it at that point. And James called off the argument and he said, this is clearly what the prophet Amos spoke about. This is the house of David that God is raising up. The tabernacle of David, the booth of David that God is raising up, which is the church. So the house of David, we should always refer to the church being the house of David, because it is. why is the church the house of David? Remember what we studied back in 2 Samuel chapter 7? God promised David a kingdom, a house, and a throne. Right? And God also said to David in that same passage that I will build you a house. And then he said, your son, your zerah, actually your descendant, your seed, he will build you the house. So is there a contradiction there? God says, I will build you a house. And then it says, your seed, he will build you the house. Well, the conclusion is that God would be represented in the seed of David, who is the Tzemach, the offshoot. And he's the one to build the house. And so that's the house of David, right? We are the house of David. And why do I have to believe in this? Because Christianity is oblivious to this. Completely oblivious to it. And is there any value in saying that we're the house of David? Tremendous value in saying that we are the house of David. Tremendous value. If you read Zechariah chapter 12, and we will, as time moves along, Zechariah chapter 12, 1 to 9 is Armageddon. It is the battle in Jezreel. And what we see in that battle is that the house of David is positioned at that time in Jerusalem. And that the house of David is providing tremendous support for Israel. It's an incredible passage in Zechariah chapter 12, 1 to 9. We'll read that another time. But the point is, the house of David is referenced there twice as being a strong support for Israel, as Israel is being attacked by all the nations. And their position in Jerusalem. So on a timeline, relative to the rapture, relative to the coming of the Messiah, where would that be? Where would we place that event when the house of David would be a strong support for Israel?
Just before the coming.
Or just after?
Or just after.
After. I think it's just after. Because we're positioned in Jerusalem. We're called the inhabitants of Jerusalem, the house of David. By the way, that's where the house of David belongs. The house of David, tabernacle of David, was set up where? In the heart of Jerusalem, where we belong. And so it says it in Zechariah chapter 12, the inhabitants of Jerusalem, the house of David, a strong support for Israel. And Israel will say it. What a strong support for us are these, the inhabitants of Jerusalem, the house of David, through the Lord of hosts, their God. It says, we should go read it perhaps. If we read it, we'll go off for 20 minutes. And I don't want to go off for 20 minutes. But you read it yourself and you'll see it. So the house of David, the reference of the house of David is very relevant to the church's destiny, where we're going as a people. Right, the house of David, we are a people, our identity, the house of David. How many of us have heard of or have known about the two staple, the two house people? Ben and Ephraimite, two staple, two house, redeemed Israel, they go by different names, right? You know, all of these startup type movements, they change their name, they change identity. As time goes along, they realize how wrong they are in certain areas and they adapt and change. The Seventh-day Adventists did it. The Jehovah's Witnesses did it. The Flat Earthers do it quite a bit. The Sacred Name people today, they do the same thing. They adapt and change as they realize how off they are in their belief. And that's why, for me, stay with the Bible and you don't have to adapt and change. But the Two House people have done a lot of that. The Two House movement, we've talked about this before, but was initiated by a woman by the name of Batia Wooten. And like I've told you before, she came right here in that little quiet room right there and attempted to persuade Ken and John that this is a viable movement and they need to get on board with it. And the Two House movement basically takes the position that if you are a Christian, Anglo, by the way, and meaning that you come from the Northern Europe. this is the connection to Manifest Destiny that I spoke about a few weeks ago. If you are a Christian and you are identifying with Israel, you find yourself looking to Israel, it means that you have a genetic connection to the Northern kingdom. You descended from the northern kingdom, or the ten lost tribes. And so you have this huge movement. I think the movement is waning now. It's diminishing quite rapidly, I think. They don't have the same steam that they had a few years ago. But it gained momentum. It did rise to a high crescendo. And there's still a lot of people that are in the Hebraic Roots movement that are still believing in the two states. The stick of Judah and the stick of Ephraim. And so the movement is also called the stick of Ephraim. It's confusing. I'll make it simple. They believe, and Batya Wooden advanced the idea or the theory that if you're the friend of Israel, you are of the ten lost tribes. Because the ten lost tribes were taken by the Assyrians and taken into Europe, specifically Northern Europe. And Manifest Destiny came up with this nonsense 120 years ago, where the word Brit or British is the Hebrew word for covenant. And so the British man, Ish is man, Brit covenant man, British. And so that they came away with the idea that all of the Nordic people, the British and the Scandinavians and the all of those very, very Anglo peoples are actually the ten lost tribes. And the reason Christians are waking up to them today is because that identity is coming to bear, because the time for the two states to be reconnected is upon us. What's wrong with that idea? If you understood what I just shared with you, what's wrong with that? Fundamentally, what's wrong with it?
The Northern Europeans are not Semitic.
Well, these people would say that they are. They are, right? And then the Assyrians pushed them into Northern Europe. There's no historical evidence to indicate anything like that. Alright, so, but this is what these people believe. And that the two houses was the house of Ephraim and the house of Israel, the house of Judah and the house of Ephraim. And so they gave themselves incredible relevance and importance when they did this. And it was actually a reaction to the Messianic movement. Because the Messianic church now came along, and therefore their position was, I'm a natural Jew, and you're not a natural Jew, but if you want to become and be a part of this, you know, you can really tell me, but you'll never be up front, because you're not a natural Jew. And a lot of people felt really put out by that, and they felt left out. And these are the ones, Batya Wooten and others, who went out and gave themselves some relevance, some identity. Came up with this idea. So how did this thing come to an end? I think the Holy Spirit shut it out. I think God shut it out. And He used yours truly in the process. He used yours truly in the process. It took me a while to come to terms with that, but finally I had to deal with that fact. Yes, God did in fact use me to shoot that whole thing down. And I'll share with you how it happened. We were in Israel, we were in Kibbutzim, and it was an incredible year. Incredibly profound, prophetic, and powerful. Things were happening wherever we went. And so David Levine, who's one of the people in Kibbutzim, one of our friends, comes to me and he says, there's a group of Christians in Ariel that wants to meet you. They've seen you on the internet, and they're fascinated by you, they want to come and talk to you. And I'm carrying a bucket of dirt here. Like, I'm really fascinated, right? I'm carrying two buckets of dirt, and I'm looking at them. Me? Where did they see me? Well, a video on the internet. All right. Okay, well, I'll talk to anyone that will come over. Okay? So, about three vineloads of Bene Ephraimites, two stick people, pulled up the next day. Took me about 5 seconds to recognize who they were. Because I was acquainted with what they believed and the way they dressed, the way they conducted themselves. So these were two houses. It took me a while, it took me a few minutes to actually say, yes, these are two houses, but it came to me. So I'm at the park, and I know that they want to talk to me, they're here to see me. And so they formed a big, under one of the pergolas, a big group of them, about 20 of them. sat there and they waited for me to come up there, and I was like, what in the world am I getting into here? Mm-hmm. I'm not prepared to share anything with anyone. This is kind of embarrassing. So anyway, I went up there and I got in front of them, and they started firing questions at me, like, how did you get to be here? How did you get to do this work here? What is this about? How did this happen? And so I shared to the best of my ability about how we ended up in Ketuvim. And then finally, the woman who sat right in the middle, who, from my perspective, she was incredibly important, because everyone deferred to her almost. Every time they said something, they would look to her. The woman in the middle, she sent a signal to one of the guys, a guy that was clearly a leader in the group, and he kind of shushed everyone. He looked at me and he says, do you know the truth? And my mom, it's a trick question. So I said, yeah, I think I know the truth. Now, David Levine, he's a Jew, he's standing right next to me, right? So I got to think about his sensitivities. So I said, sure, I know the truth. He said, no, the guy who was taking the leadership role in the group. He said, no. He says, I'm talking about the truth about the two houses. I said, yeah, I know the truth about the two houses. You guys are replacement theologists. As it turned out, the 20-something people that were there were all leaders of the movement. Mm-hmm. From Northern Europe, from England, from Holland, from New Zealand, from Australia. They were all the leaders. They were in Ariel seeking citizenship in Israel. And it looked like they were going to get it. The municipality at Ariel had become comfortable with them, and the government were deliberating whether they should have citizenship in Israel or not. Now, I knew why they were looking for citizenship in Ariel. Because Ariel is the region of Ephraim. Mm-hmm. And they see themselves as Ephraimites. And so, they would get to claim their stake in the land of Israel as Christians. So, of course, when I said you're a replacement theologist, it just went, what? And I was shocked by my response, because I didn't think, I didn't pre-think, I didn't plan it. It just, oh, you're a replacement theologist. And I waited for the response, and they kind of went quiet for a few moments. And then the guy looked at the woman in the middle, who turned out to be Batia Wuhu. And she looked at him, and he looked at me and said, what do you mean, replacement? I said, well, I think you have identity crisis. I think you have identity crisis, because you're here to take the position that you are Ephraim. You represent the tribes of Ephraim, the state of the Northern Kingdom, and you're not. You're all Christians. I said, your identity is, and this is the point, I said, your identity is the house of David. That's where you should put your emphasis. Not being the house of Israel. You have an identity crisis. And the conversation went back and forth. And then finally, Batya Wooten said, we can agree to disagree. And she started gathering the things. And the pastor, well, one of the leaders, the pastor from New Zealand, said, no, I want to hear what he has to say. So they gave me another 15 minutes. And I carefully illustrated for them how they have no right to identify with the Northern Kingdom, and that they're here to take territory away from Israel, claiming to be of the Northern Kingdom, and this is replacement theology. Because you're here to replace the actual sons of Israel. And it was like, I mean, every time I would strike them, they would start looking at each other and start getting anxious. So that came to an end. And I went back to work. And they took off, and then David Levine comes by that night, late in the evening, and he says, first of all, he said, I don't understand anything you said. Or anything they said. He says, I am so out of it. I don't know what transpired. But please tell me what transpired. What did you say to them? Because they argued among themselves all the way back. He said it was bad. They were really fracturing their relationships were being a challenge.
Dispersed.
And what did you say to them? I said, well, I don't think, first of all, I said anything to them, really. Because I didn't plan to. I had nothing planned. It was just what came out of me. But it was the Holy Spirit. And from that moment on, from that time on, they lost their opportunity to live in Israel. They were exposed for who they were after that. And they didn't succeed to live in Israel as they wanted. And then it was a matter of about 6 months later, the whole movement began to disassemble. And they're basically non-existent today. Now, their teachings are still out there. A lot of people in the Hebraic root movement, they're still, you know, you see those little diagrams of the two sticks wrapped together, and there's still a remnant of that stuff out there. But it's just bad teaching. It's just bad teaching. It denotes, again, an identity crisis. We have an identity as Christians. It is the house of David. So Jeremiah chapter 33, the text that we're talking about, illustrates that the house of David, the house of Israel, the total house of Israel, will be kept by God, will always be the people before God. So we talk about the two witnesses. The two witnesses. John Hagee, about 12 years ago, taught on dual covenants. And this was one of his points, that the house of David and the house of Israel are preserved before God. The house of David is the church. He made the point very emphatically, better than I could ever make the point. And that the house of David and the house of Israel represent God's two witnesses. Dual covenant. And the AG, the Assembly of God, the leadership of the Assembly of God, really cracked down on John Hagee and basically told him that you have to recant. You have to pull that statement back, and he did. He did. About 3 or 4 weeks later, he came out and he softened up his message, and he basically said that he really wasn't talking about dual covenant. So I had a lot of respect for John Hagee, but he should have never compromised with the Assemblies of God. Mm-hmm. God would have kept his ministry. God would have sustained his church. The fear, of course, was that he had a young son that was coming up 10, 12 years ago to take his place in a huge cornerstone ministry church. He was going to lose it. And the inner circle of the Assemblies of God, people that I know that were in that circle, they all knew that he compromised. So, anyway, so God is gracious, but he did preach the truth concerning the dual covenants, that God has two covenanted people. The church in Israel. It didn't fit into the Assemblies of God pale of doctrine, so they had to tighten them up on that. Mm. Very unfortunate what happened there. But fortunately, myself and Fellowship Church, we don't have a headship governing over us other than Jesus himself. Jesus has no problem with his word. His word is clear. God has two covenanted peoples. And God's covenant with Israel is still viable, still working. The evidence is right before us. Mm-hmm. All right, so let's move on. House of David, house of Israel. Jeremiah's message to the remnant remaining in the land, chapter 42. Don't leave the land. Don't leave. Stay in the land. Don't leave. God's going to bring a restoration. So maybe we should read. Let's go to chapter 42, I think it is. Chapter 42. Almost by breaking. Let's see, chapter 42, I want to say it's verse 15. God had delivered them from Egypt. tithe and then come back. So God is saying, don't do it. All right, so the parables of Jeremiah, the wasteland, which is Jeremiah chapter 13, I think 11 to 21. What's the essence of the parable of the wasteland? He was to take a new wasteland and...
There it is.
Let it rot. What was the symbolic of? It's symbolic of what will happen to the house of Israel, to the house of Judah in this case. He went to the potter's shop, chapter 18, 1 to 12. What was the parable of the potter? He observed the potter, right? So, right, he made a vessel, and then the potter decided that, well, he didn't like it, so he crushed it and he made another one. And what was God's move to Jeremiah? Well, effectively, the whole thing with the potter is to illustrate that he is sovereign God, and he makes his decision based on his own determination. He can build up, he can take down, he can judge or not judge. The broken jar, chapter 19, 1 and 2. Parable of the broken jar. Chapter 19, 1 and 2. Someone read those verses for us. Sacrifices to other gods. So the whole point of the broken jar is that God's going to break Jerusalem. He's going to destroy Jerusalem, which is exactly what he did. This wasn't a good message for Jeremiah to deliver, but none of his messages were good if you were looking for hope in Jerusalem at that time, because Jerusalem at that time was slated for destruction. And this goes back to God's parable when he spoke through Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 5, the parable of the vineyard. What was the parable of the vineyard? Well, there was an indictment against the growers, the workers in the vineyard, that they were not faithful. And as a result, God was going to destroy his vineyard. And he would destroy the tower that was built in the middle of the vineyard. Now the tower there is a reference to the temple. And the vineyard is Israel. The vine growers are those who were formed to give leadership to Israel, who were not faithful. Now this was a powerful parable in Isaiah chapter 5. Jesus himself recited or repeated the same parable in Matthew chapter 21. The difference is Jesus added quite a bit to the parable. He could have, it was his parable to begin with. And in Jesus' parable in Matthew chapter 21, he went on to say that God will take this kingdom from you, unfaithful wine growers, and give the kingdom to another people. A people who would be faithful with what? Faithful with?
The vineyard.
The vineyard is Israel. And, of course, the people that would be receiving the vineyard would be the people of another nation that Jesus said that God will bring into existence. That nation is the house of David. See, one of the things I told the two-state people in Kidumin, I think this was my strongest point, if I can remember correctly. Jim was here, so he can tell me. One of the things I told them is, I said, you're negating for yourselves a powerful and an incredible position before God, the house of David. Royal priesthood and all that comes with it, and you're forsaking it to be of the house of Israel. I asked him, I said, how many of you have done DNA tests and come back with negative results? They all went like, ooh, don't talk about that. Because that at that time was a big issue, right? Because everyone was doing DNA tests to determine if they had any Jewish blood, and they all must have. And they all came back with negative results.
That's what I said at the beginning, that we're not Semitic.
Yes, of course. So the point is, I told them, you negated for yourself an outstanding for a tremendous position in the house of David, this royal priesthood, for being a part of the tribes of Israel. That's why David had a lot of questions for me when he came back, but that's okay. So, good figs, bad figs, another parable, chapter 24. What's the essence of that parable? Good figs, bad figs. The good figs are the ones who are faithful to God, yes. Specifically, the good figs are the ones who will obey God and accept what he was about to do in Jerusalem. Not resist what he was about to do. The bad figs were the ones who were saying, God is not going to destroy this country. We're not about to enter into judgment. God's not going to destroy Jerusalem. They were the bad figs. The good figs were the ones who were saying, God, we don't like it, but whatever you do is good. We're going to trust you. Those were the good figs.
That will preach.
I preached it before, and I suspect I'll be preaching it before the end of the month. So, Prophet Amos. Let's talk about Amos. So, what was the basic message of Amos to the Northern Kingdom? Judgment. Northern Kingdom, you don't have a chance. God's going to destroy you completely. You're apostate. You should have never existed to begin with. God's going to destroy you. That was the message of Amos. He discussed quite a few points concerning the day of the Lord. You know, that he made that iconic statement about the day of the Lord. What would the day of the Lord be like? Mm-hmm. God's day in that sense would be judgment. As it relates to the Northern Kingdom, a day of gloom, a day of destruction. So, if you were part of the Northern Kingdom, you shouldn't be looking forward to the day of the Lord. Now, for us in Messiah, we can say that I say I'm looking forward to the day of the Lord, but I'm not ignorant. I know what the day of the Lord will bring. I know what it means. It means incredible destruction. The destruction of the Northern Kingdom is nothing compared to what's coming, and how difficult the struggles will be to stand in that day. But in Messiah, having the mind of God, well, the dimension of the mind of God, I'm looking forward to it. Because what do I have to be afraid of? Paul said to die is gain. Mm-hmm. To die is to gain. To live is to serve Christ, to serve Messiah. So if I live on, I live to serve him. If I die, I gain. What do I gain? I gain everything. I lose nothing and I gain everything. Alright. Amos also said that there's a famine, a shortage of God's word. Now Amos was the prophet, Amos chapter 9, who talked about the tabernacle of David, that God would raise up the tabernacle of David. Of course, he wasn't referring to the literal tabernacle, he was referring to the church, the house of David, the booth of David, the tabernacle of David. Hosea, Prophet Hosea, compared the relationship of Hosea's wife, Gomer, with God and Israel. She was a prostitute, and the idea was the allegorical picture there is that Israel is the prostitute, and God is the faithful husband who is being betrayed. The names of the three children and their meanings. And Hosea chapter 1. So, Hosea had a wife who was a prostitute. that he had children with this prostitute.
For justification.
But in Hebrew, they're the same word. So when Habakkuk says, the just shall live by, or the righteous shall live by faith, you can say the justified shall live by faith. So the New Testament comes along, now Paul comes and he tells us that the righteous shall live by faith, or the justified shall live by faith. Those who are justified will be done so by faith. And in Paul's argument, not by the works of the law. So you're justified by faith. So Habakkuk made this iconic statement, and it does point back to God's relationship with Abraham. Right? Genesis chapter 15, the night that the covenant was made or cut with Abraham, Abraham believed God, and it was attributed to him as righteousness. Some Bibles would say justification because of that Greek influence, the New Testament influence. So Abraham became just by faith, or became righteous by faith. Same principle. So it's the only way that we can become righteous or justified before God. It's by faith, not by what we do, not by our giftedness or our capacity for ministry. None of those things really illustrates that we're justified with God. Only faith, and faith only. Alright. So Zephaniah, his message was more or less the same, judgment. God's going to bring judgment. Zephaniah had some wonderful statements as well in Zephaniah chapter 3 about God's ultimate dwelling place would be in Zion. The redeemed of the Lord shall return and come with singing on Zion, and so on. Zephaniah chapter 3. Alright, Obadiah. Obadiah's message was mostly focused to Esau, or Edom, the Edomites, or the sons of Esau. And they were particularly grievous to God, because while they were being punished by God, they increased the punishment by inflicting hardships upon Israel as they were being punished by God. And God took offense to that. So the book of Obadiah, which is only how many books? How many chapters? Like two chapters or something, Obadiah? It was directed to Esau, what Esau did. All right, so Jonah and Nahum. Last week we talked about those two prophets. Jonah and Nahum, we basically recanted the whole story of Jonah. Right? So Jonah was a prophet to Nineveh. Who were the Ninevites? Assyrians. They were Assyrians. Who were the Assyrians? Sons of Ashur. Who were Semitic people? Son of Shem. Interesting with the sons of Asher or the Assyrians, they stayed very close to where Noah and Shem lived, at the foot of Mount Ararat. They didn't wander far away from there. And I personally believe that the Assyrians had a sort of a special relationship with God. Not based on a covenant such as one with Abraham, but based on the covenant that God had established with Noah. That he had established with Noah. Because the Assyrians, the sons of Asher, stayed close to Shem and knew the God of Shem, or God of Noah. You know, the Assyrians, the descendants of the Assyrians today, they're still there. They're still there generally in that area, and most of them are very ancient Christians. Very, very ancient Christians. They're wonderful people. Wonderful people. Mm-hmm. And they're very spiritual. Their women are warriors. Their women are tough warriors. It's from those women that the legend of the Amazonians came from. During the time of the Greeks, these women who lived in the area of Ararat were warriors. And they would fight with the Grecians, against the Grecians and so on. The Grecians called them Amazonians. That's where the legend of the Amazonians came from. Today they're called, what are they called today? The people of northern Turkey that are fighting against Turkey, they're called Kurds. Kurds? Kurdish? Kurdistan? Kurdish people. And they stood up against ISIS. And they're women who were fighting ISIS and beating ISIS back. You don't remember that? About 4 or 5 years ago?
Yeah, I remember.
And ISIS was horrified by them because they were afraid of the women.
British
women. Yeah, and ISIS was horrified. There were several articles about it. And these women were triumphant. They knew that ISIS was fleeing from them. ISIS didn't want, no ISIS warrior wanted to be taken on by a woman. These women were on the front line. They were snipers, they were soldiers. Well, these are the descendants of these people. They still speak Aramean today. These are the descendants of the Assyrians. Yeah, still there today. Anyway, that's just an interesting research that I did. You can look at that yourself. It's valid, it's very real, it's very powerful. They gain a lot of respect from the people of Israel. In fact, Israel has a special love for the Kurds because of them. Mm-hmm. And so does the Kurds towards Israel. There's a special connection there. I have several friends who are Kurdish, and you can see that the basis of that relationship really strong between them and Israel.
Don't the Kurds live in Syria?
Northern Syria, yes. That area. So, the Kurds is a very broad identifier for these people, but they exist in this area we are pointing to right now.
Okay.
So Turkey is over here, right?
Right.
And east of Turkey is the troubled people of the Kurds. They're called Kurdistan. Many of them are Muslims. Kurdistan, that's where you get Kurdistan from. But interspersed with these Kurdish people are the descendants of the Assyrians. Mm-hmm. And there's pockets of them all throughout this area. And their women are incredible warriors. It's an amazing thing. Husbands are working the farms, and their women are holding with weapons. And they're very good warriors. I'm telling you, they're dreaded in the Muslim world. There's some wonderful videos on the internet of they having victory dances. And they dance in a very unique, a very specific way. They're not the Kano people at all. Kano. I said the soldiers dance, the ladies dance, but it's not sensual at all. It's a beautiful dance, a victory dance that they do that goes all the way back. Right, so according to what I've read, this is where the legend of the Amazonians come from. And the Grecian soldiers, the Grecian warriors at that time were afraid of them because they were known for good fighting tactics. Did you find something on them?
Yeah,
everything
said like ISIS.
Yeah, ISIS, before Trump and his efforts brought an end to ISIS, they were, these ladies were wrecking them. I mean, really wrecking them. The snipers were extremely effective. Because, from what I've read, most of the times ISIS would turn their backs and run. If you're a sniper, turn your back. Well, so these ladies were really, really effective. They have a history of being warriors that goes all the way back. I don't know where it began, but they have a history of being warriors. And when the issue came up with ISIS, they geared themselves up and they went out and fight. They literally left their children at home with their husbands and went out and fight. So, it's interesting, right? Have you seen any of the dances yet? Victory dances?
No,
okay. All right, so I think we can take a break here, come back at 9:15. Come back at 9:15 and we'll continue. Study guys, where are we at now, study guys? You guys are supposed to be so studious, so on top of it. Tell me where are we? Study guys.
We are to be
list the Gentile cities, countries that Amos prophesied against.
You should be willing to endure the hardships that will come.
There were
locusts and fire.
The swarms of locusts, pestilence, and fire, plague of fires. What did he ultimately decide upon?
Exile.
That he would drive them out. The great famine that's coming in Amos' time to Jacob is a famine of what? The word of God. Scarcity of the word of God. Even though Jacob is, and you know what? It's an amazing reality that we're in today. There is no shortage of money books, right? You have the Gideon organization that has published Bibles for the last 100 years. They're everywhere. You can pick up a dozen at Walmart at any time of the day. And yet there's a shortage of God's word. No shortage of Bibles, but there's a shortage of God's word.
I just wanted to know what's usually given as the reason for the big gap between the end of the Old Testament and the beginning of the New Testament. Why there was no word from God between that time?
Well, between that intertestament period, right? To say that there wasn't any word from God, I don't think it's correct, because you have a story of the Maccabees that occurs during that period. And the Maccabees, when you read the book of Maccabees and you take the story into consideration, you see that God was speaking very clear through the actions of the Maccabees. You don't see a prophet standing and proclaiming, thus says the Lord to the Maccabees. You don't see that. But there were holy men who encouraged Israel in endeavoring during that period. So the word of God was there. It wasn't like there was absolute no showing of God's word. He was there. He was working for his people, for sure. But the last prophet of the Old Testament who was Malachi, after Malachi prophesied somewhere around 350, 325 BC. For that period from then to the time of John the Baptist, we don't see an actual prophet arising out of Israel. But it doesn't mean that God's word was, you know, non-present. So John the Baptist was the first since Malachi. And of course, to follow John the Baptist was Yeshua. Why? It's the intertestamental period. God was preparing after Malachi, after the ingathering of the exiles, Ezra, Nehemiah, and Zerubbabel, and the temple. They had that period of time there where things were difficult in Israel. They struggled with the surrounding nations, the Grecians and so on, the Syrians and the Grecians and the Arabians that struggled against them during that period. Ultimately, they would become a part of the Roman Empire, all of this during that period. They would be taken over by the Romans. In fact, Judah Maccabees, before he died, made a pact with the Romans. He made a pact with the Romans. He actually went to Rome and went before one of the emperors at that period. And he saw what was coming. He saw that the Romans, this is the book about Maccabees, he saw that the Romans were slowly advancing eastward, and that the Grecian Empire was in decline. Antiochus Epiphany had died, and he was the strongest Roman general. Ptolemy in the south had already died, and his kingdom was coming to an end. So Judah saw that the Grecians were being replaced by a variety of different people, but the Romans were coming, the Romans were growing stronger. The Romans were fighting the Parthians across the Mediterranean Ocean, and they were beating the Parthians. So Judah said, well, ultimately the Romans will come here. So he went with an entourage to Rome and made a pact with the Romans. And that's how the Romans ended up possessing the land of Israel. The Romans never fought for the land of Israel because of that agreement between Judah Maccabee and the Romans. So you had a lot of things going on that was relevant. Even though Jacob is scattered among the nations, none will be lost from God. Ultimately, God will raise up.
Follow whatever will be given.
Correct. We talked about that a little bit just now. He will raise up the fallen booth of David. And that's, of course, a symbolic reference to the church being raised up. You know, in Acts chapter 15, James, he referenced Simeon. How Simeon said from early times that God will raise up the house of David. Who is this Simeon that he's talking about? Right. The same Simeon who held Jesus on the Temple Mount when they brought him up there for the pinion and for the circumcision. And Simeon took him and said, "This is the Lord's Messiah." And he prophesied over the baby. And he prophesied concerning the nations that he'll be a sign for the nations, and the nations will gather around him, something to that effect. Well, that was the same Simeon that was being quoted by James. Because Simeon prophesied that this one would be for the nations, and that the nations will eventually be led by him, something to that effect. So when James said what he said to bring that argument to a close, the same argument that we talked about earlier, he referenced what Simeon said. What does that tell us about Simeon? He was well respected. He was regarded as a prophet, and he was well respected in Israel at that time, even to the point where the disciples, early church, had that type of reverence for him. When you can quote someone to bring it into an argument, person has a little weight. So this was Simeon. All right, that's just an interesting perspective there. Mm-hmm. All right, so Hosea. Note that Hosea, Amos both spoke during the reign of Jeroboam Ben-Yoash, a different Jeroboam, king of Israel. So this was the time when Jeroboam Ben-Yoash, son of Yoash, was the king of the northern kingdom while God was preparing to bring it to an end. What kind of life was Hosea instructed to take?
A harlot.
And what did this signify?
Israel's unfaithfulness.
That, right. Israel was a harlot, unfaithful to God. What were the names of the three children of Hosea? We talked about this just now. Jezreel, Lo Ruhamah, Lo Ami. Jezreel meaning God's planting or fruitfulness. It points to Jezreel, the place where many wars are fought. Lo Ruhamah, no compassion, no mercy. Lo Ami, you're not my people. Now, Hosea did go on to say, whereas it was said that you are not my people, it would be said that you are the sons of the living God. So isn't that something? He says it right there in the same chapter, chapter 1 of Hosea, in referring to the restoration. Whereas it was said that you are not my people, it will be said that you are the sons of the living God. That's pretty profound. You know, I like when replacement theologists, they run to Hosea. Well, Hosea said this and Amos said that. And they build their argument from replacement theology, right? Without really looking into what Hosea and Amos actually said. It's just cherry picking from the Bible to support your wrong doctrinal position to begin with. I don't like to see that. That's, you know, when I was a quote unquote unbeliever, the truth is I was always a believer. Even when I didn't act like a believer, I was always a believer. But when I was totally discouraged from Christianity and didn't want anything to do with it, these were the things that really discouraged me. The way that preachers would cherry pick to create their positions. So they begin from a place of erroneous doctrine, right? Clearly against what the Bible teaches, and they would pull a little here, pull a little there, pull a little there, and form a contraption. And the contraption is designed just to deceive people, to entrap people into their particular doctrinal position. Yeah, and that's not necessarily bad if your points are really absolutely biblical. You can do that. I do that from time to time. But one of the things I try to do is to ensure that whatever I say can be really supported by the Bible. Now, it may not be supported by a certain appropriate appropriation of what it says. In other words, you can extrapolate anything from a verse. And I might say, for instance, God says very clearly that Israel will be his people. You know, for instance, Hosea, you're not my people, but whereas it was said that you're not my people, it will be said that you're sons of the living God. Well, I've heard people take that, preachers take that and say, well, where it says that you're sons of the living God, clearly it's referring to the church. So they take the blessings and appropriate the blessings to themselves, and the curses, well, they keep it. Israel, you can keep the curses. We'll take the blessings because we're the church here, right? We're Christians. You're not. So it's just crazy stuff. And it was a discouragement to me for many years until I realized that I just have to believe the Bible and not concern myself with what's being taught and how people are treating the Bible. And that's when I cleared up a lot for me. That's why I have such an edge on me towards wrong teachings. Because it's horrible what people do with the Bible. The Bible says it, I believe it, that settles it.
Well, he doesn't want anyone to add or delete to his word.
Or take away from it, I mean, really. So, there used to be a bumper sticker like that. The Bible says it, I believe it, and that settles it. I need to get one of those bumper stickers. The prince of those up. With a big menorah in the background. Even though Israel is to be dispersed, what did God ultimately promise to do?
Mm-hmm.
Bring him back and restore. We read that a little bit on tonight. When Israel returns, who will be their king? Son of David. Son of David, the Tzemach, the branch, Yeshua. What is the charge against Israel? No, we're reading Hosea again, Hosea chapter 4 now. Right. Idolatry, adultery and everything else. Bad things. What spirit has led Israel astray? Idolatry, spirit of adultery. You know it's a spirit, right? It's a spirit. It's a spirit. You embrace it and it takes you over, just like any other spirit. And there are some mean spirits associated with sensuality. Some mean ones. And when you become susceptible to them, they're captured. They're tough spirits to deal with.
Yeah.
I've done some deliverances with people who had that spirit of adultery. It takes years in some cases. Years. Yeah, but then I see good things as well. I see recovery. I see people blossoming and being in God's favor clearly following deliverance. So it's one of those things, you know. I wish I had a magic stick. I wish I had God's perfect will for everyone's life. I just wish, oh, for me, you're over that spirit of adultery. You're over that spirit of pornography. You're over that spirit of vain imagination. You're over all of that. But that's not how it works. The person who has the spirit has to be willing to surrender.
Right.
And if that person is willing to surrender, then they can be absolute deliverance.
And then if they open the door, then
yeah. All right, so the spirit of adultery, the spirit of idolatry. When will God's presence return to Israel?
When they
make amends for their sins, when they call upon God and repent. God delights in what?
Obedient
heart, humility as well, but an obedient heart. When Ephraim, Israel, was troubled, where did he look for help? Syria, Egypt, even looked to Assyria. Assyria didn't provide much help for him at all. God again ultimately raised up these people, the Assyrians, to come against Israel. And they did that. The ancestors of the same Kurdish warriors that we just saw, the ancestors of the Assyrians, God raised them up to descend upon Israel. What was the calf? What is the calf of Samaria? Jeroboam's calf, a golden calf, which he obviously picked up from Egypt. Remember Jeroboam, he ran to Egypt when God called him to lead the northern kingdom for a period of time. He went to Egypt and he came back with the notion of the golden calf and created an apostasy in the northern kingdom. Why are the leaders of Israel, the prophets and inspired men, fools? Right, they were hostile to God, they engaged in iniquity, and they were, from God's perspective, fools. Israel's idols will be carried off to Assyria. Numbers 11, 12, 13, recount the history of Jacob. Yes. What caused Israel to stumble? Iniquity. There's even a spirit of iniquity. Every sin has with it a governing spirit or a governing demonic entity that will govern in that particular area. Iniquity, really, in Hebrew, is tendency towards sin. So there's a specific, in other words, if you go far into demonology, there's a principality or demon that's assigned the sin of iniquity or the tendency, given the tendency towards sin. So that complicates things a little bit. So even the tendency towards sin we have to overcome, because it's demonic, it's satanic, it's spiritual. And it gives a certain amount of hope, because it means that we can be delivered of that spirit, we can be delivered of even the tendency, iniquity, the tendency towards sin. Okay, what is God's promise to Ephraim? Right, God will ultimately restore you. Explain the different effects of the way of the Lord on the righteous and the wicked transgressors. If you're in the book of Hosea, read chapter 14, verse 9. Someone, chapter 14, verse 9. Amos, or Hosea. The last verse in the book of Hosea. Yeah.
Who is wise? Let him understand these things. Who is prudent? Let him know them. The ways of the Lord is right. The righteous walk in them, but transgressors stumble in them.
Right. So the way of the Lord, right? Mm-hmm. All right, have a cook. We have 15 minutes. We can do this. Have a cook. In this book, Habakkuk asks God various questions, and God responds. The first question directed to God is chapter 1 of Habakkuk. What's the first question?
How long, O Lord, will I call for help, and thou wilt not hear?
Right. You find that in the Psalms, in David's Psalms, there are a lot of questions like that. So they're repeated throughout many of the Psalms. Why are you not responding? Why am I in such a place, peril? And the Psalms are very much like that. God's reply is, verse 5, anyone?
He's going to destroy the
Israel.
I'm going to bring judgment.
Okay. Right, God is determined to bring judgment. Remember how the book is a prophet like Jeremiah. He's simply announced what God's about to do and trying not to whine about it too much. Jeremiah fussed a little bit about it and God said, do not trouble me with the repentance of these people any longer. Do not pray for these people any longer. Because God had a plan, and his plan was to bring judgment. Same thing with Habakkuk. It's a difficult place to be one of these prophets. Mm-hmm. Right? One of these prophets that are basically announcing what God's about to do when it's not good. It's easy to announce what God is doing when it's good.
Yes.
There's no issues there at all. When you gotta proclaim God's judgment, well, that's a different thing, right? So, you know, someone said to me yesterday, reminded me that the position of prophet and pastor is one of the most difficult positions in terms of the fivefold ministry, right? The fivefold ministry, and in Ephesians chapter 5, you have pastor, evangelist, apostles, and fivefold, whatever they are. Teacher, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and whatever. And every now and again, you will encounter someone who has the office of pastor and prophet. You're kind of spiritually bipolar. You're spiritually bipolar. Because you've got to get up and preach the word of God. And it's not all the street world, right? If you're an actual prophet. At the same time, you've got to make sure that people are facilitated for. Mm-hmm. You gotta be a pastor, right? You gotta oversee and you gotta keep them. At the same time, you gotta be a prophet. That's quite. God makes no mistakes, and if He calls a preacher to be a prophet and a pastor at the same time, it's God's doing. He knows what He's doing. So I think that today, in today's world, especially among the nations, you have to be a prophet and a pastor if you're a pastor. A prophet and an evangelist. An evangelist. What's an evangelist? A preacher. We think an evangelist is someone who goes out to evangelize. That's not what the word evangelism means. The word evangelism means to preach. So to preach. Any preacher is an evangelist. If he's preaching judgment, he's preaching repentance, he's preaching God's favor, he's an evangelist. He's a preacher. So the prophet and the pastor, that's a tough office. Especially today. Because so many times I'm led to get up and say, separate from your extreme patriotism. It's about to come to a tough place. That's the will of God. And people don't take kindly to it. They resist it. Kind of like what the Israelites, the Jerusalemites did with Jeremiah. Surely God's not going to bring judgment on God's land. Well, that's a tough one, right? And you got to get up and proclaim it. And then you got to take some people out to lunch. So being a prophet and a pastor is a difficult office. It's not very pleasant at times. But you do it. You do what you have to do.
Did you realize at the same time that you were both?
Yeah, that came to me one morning. When I first got called, I struggled with, you know, because I wanted to continuously bring a nice, pleasant message for the congregation, one that made everyone feel good. And I started doing that for a while, but I knew in my spirit it wasn't who I was. It wasn't what God wanted me to do. But it felt good at that time because everyone was, hey, that's really nice. That's good. Praise God. And one morning God dealt with me. And he basically said to me, you can preach that message if you want, but it's not my message. And so I had to correct myself, and I made a commitment that I'm going to preach, I'm going to deliver exactly what God wants, and teach exactly what God wants me to teach. And if it offends someone, well, sorry, take your lunch. You know, and that's the way it goes. That's why I'm getting so fat. So it's a tough position. It's a tough position. And someone prophesied one morning that Friday morning that you're called to be a pastor, but you're also a prophet. And don't try to get away from it. So, okay. So I had to settle down with the simple reality that I'm called to be a prophet at this incredible time in this country, seeing what's coming, knowing what's coming. And if I sit with you privately, if you're able to hear it, it will shock you. What's happening in this country and what's coming, what God has shown me. And so it's difficult. It's not something I would share with any, just anyone, because it's very difficult to embrace. Suffice to say that difficult times are coming.
Yes.
Difficult, very difficult times are coming. Most Americans will be in a position where they will feel completely betrayed by the government.
I already feel that way.
You already feel that way. It's going to compound many times.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, that's a tough thing to deal with, but what do you do? You can't hold it back. So what are most preachers doing? They're circumventing that issue completely.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not the only person that sees this. Many people see it, but they prefer not to touch it, not to deal with it. You know, preach a nice, happy message, make everyone feel good. Some preachers have gone completely over to the social justice gospel. Someone told me yesterday that Joel Hunter has gone completely social justice. He's preaching that BLM has a right to do what they're doing. Antifa is in a place of righteousness, seeking what is good, what is right. That's what Joel Hunter is doing now. Was built on that type of message, you know, repentance, humility, brokenness before. doesn't exist. It exists, but in small pockets. Anyway, let's finish up. So before I interrupted myself, where did I start? Habakkuk? Is it? Habakkuk?
Habakkuk, yes,
declared. The righteous shall walk by faith. Alright, so even though the situation becomes desperate, what is Habakkuk's declaration of faith? The just shall live by faith. I believe that's what it's referring to. The justified shall live by faith.
But it also says, no matter if everything's wrong, I'm still going to believe.
Yeah, okay. That's in verse 17, right?
That's at the very end.
Yeah, verse 17. All right. Let's see if we can run through some of these here really quick. The central theme of Zephaniah is judgment again. During the reign of king, of what king did Zephaniah prophesy? Josiah. Zephaniah speaks of judgment coming to Judah and Jerusalem. Beyond this, he says that God will do what? To face to the face of the earth. Cut off man from the face of the earth. That's a tough one to digest. What does Zephaniah advise of the humble of the earth to do? What did the people in Nineveh, how did they respond? They repented. That made Jonah what? Very mad. Why did Jonah originally flee from God's word? We talked about this a little last week. Perhaps he knew indeed that they would repent, that God had interest in them. And we talked about that a little bit last week. God demonstrated his grace and mercy for the people of Nineveh. Think of this relative to Jonah chapter 3, verse 16, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. Nahum speaks of what city? Nineveh. His message is total, no repentance. It is coming, you can't get away from it. God's going to put an end to this existence, this pitiful existence of your city Nineveh. All right, so I think we can stop there. Next week, we'll begin to get to the prophet's screen. And by the way, I have to pass out.
Just give me 10 seconds.